Well, hello again and welcome to another episode of the Hyperion Adventures Podcast. I'm Tom. As always, I'm with my wonderful, intelligent, gorgeous, very hardworking Disney Songs with Meaning loving wife and co-host Michelle.
Well, thank you, sweetie. And hi, everybody.
Hello, everybody. Indeed, we are recording this episode on Sunday, October 13th, 2024. And boy, it has been quite a week here in Florida.
An understatement.
That is an understatement, very much so. But thank you for joining us today. As you know, we're going to do things a little bit differently than we have in the past, skimming over some of the stuff we would bring up at the beginning, moving that to the end. However, we always want to focus on the positive from the week that was, because this is the Disney show of podcast, the Disney podcast of positivity. Boy, it must have been a tough week because I am a mess this morning.
I know.
We are the Disney podcast of positivity, which means that we always like to focus on those high moments, those wonderful moments, those positive moments from the week that was. We call it my favorite thing from this week. And when we do this, we always start with Michelle because she's amazing. She's spectacular. She's fantastic. You know, she does the best research. You've heard that in the past. She definitely has the best lists. I think you're about to hear that. She also has the best My Favorite Thing from this week. So, Michelle, what is your favorite thing from this week?
Well, I think my favorite thing of this week, hands down, is the fact that we did okay.
We did okay.
With a hurricane coming through and didn't lose power, which was especially helpful for Scott's well-being. And also that our dear friends on the west coast of Florida, who we were really worried about with the storm hitting mainly on that side of the coast, that they did okay too.
Yeah, my favorite thing from this week is that many of us made it through this thing just fine. Now, there are several people throughout this state that's received some significant damage. Mm-hmm. There's still some flooding going on, and our thoughts and prayers are with everybody that has had to deal with that.
Right.
We did sustain a small amount of damage, just some wind damage to the soffit, which is kind of a border on the side of the roof. We think a palm frond kind of blew into it or something along those lines. There's a big palm frond right underneath where it happened. So kind of have a feeling that somebody's palm frond came off and hit it. But considering what everybody else went through, that was hardly anything at all. It was an interesting night, yes, to say the least. Scott, yes, he was nervous all night long, but he actually battled through it like a trooper. He did okay, considering we did have a kind of a blip of power out for less than a minute. It really wasn't for very long at all, thank goodness. But mostly everything here stood up okay. We were on the side that is on the east coast side of Florida. I went over all this on our live show. If you've heard the live show that I do on YouTube and Instagram and Facebook every morning, you know all this. But just in case you didn't, we were on the east coast of Florida. During the actual storm itself, we had some pretty high sustained winds, but nothing too crazy. A lot of people in the state also got a lot of rain. We were more on the dry side of it. What we had to deal with more than some other people were a lot of tornado warnings kind of prior to the storm actually getting here, more than anything else.
Right. And some actual tornadoes.
Yeah, some tornadoes somewhat nearby us. We weren't really super threatened by that, but we were getting multiple tornado warnings through that day, right,
yes,
Michelle?
Exactly.
But overall, made it through okay. And again, our thoughts are with everybody that's had to deal with this. And now we have some really nice weather in Florida. We've had a couple of really nice days, and let's hope that continues on for the foreseeable future.
Yes, yeah, for sure.
So that was our favorite thing from this week. We did receive a My Favorite Thing from this week from one of our listeners. This came from Camille in Portland. She said, "My favorite thing of this week was hanging out in Halloween Town with Mando." We live about an hour away from where the classic Disney Channel movie was filmed, and Mando had never been there before. So Lorelai showed him around. This is the way. And if you go to our Hyperion Adventurers Facebook group, you can see the pictures, which really help describe this. And yes, there's Lorelai, not only the cutest Hyperion adventurer, but also the cutest tour guide leading the Mandalorian through Halloween Town. It was fascinating to see.
It was. It was adorable, and so happy for them that they had that very extra special visit to Halloween Town.
Yeah. Very adorable. Please go to our Hyperion Adventurers Facebook group. One, sign up for it for all the fun that goes on there, but also to check out these pictures because they are absolutely adorable. You can die from the cuteness of it all.
Right?
Yes. It's very cool. All right, let's go ahead and move on to this week's show. We have lots of stuff for you this week, including when can we do this again? Well, apparently pretty soon. We'll tell you about that. And we now know when Magic Key holders will have their chance to take in an adventure through the bayou with Tiana at the Happiest Place on Earth. A preview adventure. We'll fill you in on that as well. But that's later. Let's go ahead and get to our very musical with meaning main topic of the week. So for this week's main topic, you know, it had been a little bit since we had done a musical episode. And, you know, we like to get to our list. You've always told us that those are some of your favorite shows. So we thought, why not go ahead and do that this week? And we decided to kind of delve a little deeper into some of these songs. Michelle, what are we talking about this week?
So the topic we had decided on was our top five Disney songs with a message. And originally, when I was thinking about this, I was thinking, okay, just songs with great messages for everyone. But it's funny because as I started working on the list, I started noticing that it was a much more personal list of favorite songs with messages that were impactful to me. And so today you might hear some stories about me that I haven't shared in the past.
Oh boy, a story time with Michelle. Always, that should be a new segment. It's time for story time with Michelle. Maybe a live YouTube video or something. We'll see. Story time with Michelle. I like it. I can't wait for story time with Michelle. Yes, these are songs that have meaning with their Disney songs that have kind of a message to them. Some of them are going to strike you right in the face. Like the message is obvious. It might even be right there in the title. Some of them may be a little more subtle, buried kind of within the lyrics. And yes, sometimes it'll be something that maybe is more personal to us. Sometimes it may be more globally speaking. It just is all what we like. It's our favorite. It's all very subjective, for sure, as all these lists are. These are just our favorite five songs for the moment. Ask us in a half an hour. We could be shuffling this around. Ask me as I was making the list. I was shuffling it around. I thought that this was going to be a difficult subject. I'm like, oh, maybe I'll pick out a couple songs with messages. And then as I was going through, I'm like, wow, that message is cool. That message is great, too. I actually went up way more songs possibly on my list. Definitely honorable mentions than I expected. But let's stop. Let's get right to it because, you know, we have a lot of songs to go through here. At least 10. I'm sure there'll be more. So, Michelle, let's start with the real list here because, you know, my list, you can pretty much predict it right now. Michelle's list is bound to be very, very interesting and with some, apparently some stories. So let's go ahead and get to it. Michelle, what is your number five favorite Disney song with a message?
Well, in true Hyperion Adventures podcast style, I have a 5A and a 5B.
All right. Right off the bat. I like that.
Right off the bat. And the reason that there are 5A and B is actually they're messages that kind of are similar in nature. So I figured let's take a listen to both of them and then I'll kind of just tell you why I selected them. 5A would be You'll Be in My Heart from Tarzan. Why can't they understand the way we feel? They just don't trust what they can't explain. Well, I know we're different, but deep inside us, we're not that different at all. Keep that one in mind, and let's go into my 5B, which is Colors of the Wind from Pocahontas.
You think the only people who are the people who look and think like you. But if you walk the footsteps of a stranger, you'll learn things you never knew, you never knew. Have you ever heard the wolf cry to the blue corn moon, or ask the grinning bobcat why he grinned. Can you sing with all the voices of the mountain? Can you paint with all the colors of the wind? Can you paint with all the colors of the wind?
Okay, so for these songs, like I said, they kind of have a combined message that spoke to me personally. Now, in the You'll Be in My Heart, especially the lyrics where it says, I know we're different, but deep inside us, we're not that different at all. And in Colors of the Wind, the lyrics where it says, you think the only people who are people are the people who look and think like you. But if you walk the footsteps of a stranger, you'll learn things you never knew. And to me, the message that I got from these is that, you know what? We're all human. And it's sometimes hard to see why some people think the way they do or why they feel the way they do. But if you could try to put, as they say, put yourself in their footsteps or understand that, yes, we have our differences, but we have a lot more in common. And that's the message that I thought really spoke to me in a very deep way, because when you look at how the world is today, and I'm not going to get political or anything, but there are so many overcasting feelings of distrust and toxicity that it's uncomfortable and sometimes it's scary. And I just think that we need this kind of understanding that we have more in common than different.
It's 100% true. And I think this is going to be you're going to hear this as a common theme through a few songs you're going to hear today going on as we go through these Disney songs with a message, because it is an important message that, yeah, there's a lot that's the same about us if we just take the time to look at it and know what's going on there. It definitely speaks right now, but it's not just right now, like throughout our history as a culture, as a world, not just our country. I mean, sure. Yes, of course, this country needs to take a look and listen and find all this out. But I mean, it's been through history that this has been true, that sometimes you just need to listen maybe a little bit more than you speak.
Exactly.
Yeah. So very good, Michelle's list. The best list.
So we're at your number five.
My number five favorite Disney song with a message. Well, also in true Hyperion Adventures podcast fashion, I have a 5A and a 5B as well. Both of mine happen to come from the Sherman Brothers.
Ooh.
So a little bit different thought process on each of these. Like yours tied together. Mine, I just think I tied them together because they're from the Sherman Brothers. But I think they both have interesting messages to speak to. And I'm going to start with the first one from an attraction at Walt Disney World.
Come on, everybody. Let's
go. We all have sparks. Imagination.
Yeah.
That's how our minds create creations. Right at the start of everything that's new, one little spark lights up for you.
Oh, boy!
Imagination, imagination. A dream can be a dream come true with just that spark in me and you.
Of course, one little spark from Journey into Imagination. And this is one that's going to smack you right in the face as far as the message.
Right?
It is, you know, feel free to use your imagination. You never know what you could come up with, what you could create, what interesting things can develop from it. I mean, talk about imagination, Disney throughout it, in the Disney parks in general, in these Imagineers, it's right in the name, creating these fantastic things. And all it takes is one little spark of inspiration to create them. But it could be true of anything you do in life. It could be true of art. It can be true of science. It can be true of, you know, whatever you do for a job. You never know what that one little spark of imagination could create in making processes easier, whatever. I get my spark of imagination a lot of times when I'm on trying to do anything but work out and remember, think that I'm torturing my body for periods of time. That's where I get a lot of my spark of imagination. But I kind of feel that that's something that we all need to remember from time to time, that it's good to, you know, get in and go into your mind and find these interesting things you can create.
Yeah. And let your ideas come out and flow freely.
Yes.
Agreed. Absolutely. That's a great one.
So that is my 5A. As for my 5B, this one kind of ties into Michelle's number fives as well.
It's a world of laughter, a world of tears. It's a world of hopes and a world of fears. There's so much that we share that it's time we're aware. It's a small world after all. 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 It's a small world.
So obviously, again, another message that smacks you right in the face,
right,
of, yes, look, we all share fears. We share joy. We share everything. It's a small world after all. Even though we have different cultures around this planet, there's a lot of things that make us alight. And that's
right.
What that attraction is all about, as a matter of fact. And again, that speaks to very similar to what Michelle's first song's messages were as well.
Yeah. That you're absolutely right. I love that message, and I'm just thrilled you played some songs from Attractions. That's awesome.
And now we got that stuck in your head, so you're
That's
welcome.
Right.
You're welcome.
The good thing is there's more songs to come along, so
yes,
keep listening.
So hopefully we'll get some other songs stuck in your head after this. Let's go ahead and get back to the real list, Lo. Let's get to Michelle's number four favorite Disney song with a message.
Okay, well, probably not too surprising. Again, I have an A and B.
Wow, already.
I think this is the last one, though. So, again, I selected both of these for having a similar message. And we'll play both of them first, and then I'll kind of give you the lowdown on why I picked them. So, for 4A, from Cars, the song Find Yourself.
We go through life so sure of where we're headed. Could have happened. Sometimes when you lose your way, it's really just as well. Because you find yourself, yeah, that's when you find yourself.
As we look at my 4B, which is Almost There from Princess and the Frog.
There's been trials and tribulations, you know I've had my share, but I've climbed a mountain, I've crossed a river, and I'm almost there.
So that's a good song to have in your head. But anyways, from a personal perspective, I thought both of these songs resonate the concept about, you know, knowing and finding out about your true inner self and how life's challenges can sometimes help you get to that realization and find that you do have a lot of inner strength and you really find yourself. Now, what I'm going to first say here is going to sound boastful. I'm not trying to, but I just want you to understand the process of where I got to with these songs. Personally, I know I can do big things if I put my mind to it. And I have to sometimes remind myself that because there are a lot of times that that voice inside me, you know, really hones in on my limitations and my doubts. But when I think about what I've accomplished in the past, and one example is, to me, when I wanted to go to college, I knew I had to pay my way completely. My parents didn't have the opportunity to help pay for my college, and my grades were pretty good, but they weren't going to be getting scholarships for sure. And so I knew I had to work, literally minimum pay jobs, before and throughout college. Now, what my mom did teach me though very well was how to be frugal. But then when you talk about trials and tribulations during that period of my life, when I was in school, I actually got pregnant, and I knew it wasn't going to be possible for me to keep the baby, for that child to have a great opportunity in life, because I was already financially struggling and I didn't finish college yet. So I didn't have the skills to get a great job, and knew I had to make the decision to put this child up for adoption. And, you know, like that emotional event got me off track from my studies at school. It really, you know, took its toll on me. And my grade point average for a particular nursing course didn't pass. I didn't pass. And since they only offered that once a year, I knew that meant now college is going to be a 5-year journey. And when you're already thinking, how are you going to make ends meet and make this work? Another full year of tuition at a private college, room and board costs, etc. I really didn't think I was going to do it. And I still don't know how I did it, to tell you the truth. But I made it through. And my decision was one that was a solid one. And fortunately, now I have that person back in my life. And so it's those things that life gives to you that you can really learn that you have the strength to take things on and come out better on the other side.
Yeah. Wow. That's an impactful story time with Michelle, already hitting impactfully right off the bat. Yeah. For some of you, you may not have heard that story from Michelle before. We have discussed it on this show a couple of times, but especially there's an episode, I think it's way back in our first season, our first year, where we actually brought her on and discussed all that, everything that happened. It was our very special Hyperion Adventures podcast. But yeah, and you know, to fight through that, and you know, and yes, the struggle of giving up a child for adoption to begin with, you know, and then to battle through what ended up happening with you in school and still make it through on the other side is pretty darn impressive. And so, as Michelle is always very impressive, but I've also mentioned this before, is that every once in a while, Michelle does get those little voices that come up, as we all do. I'm not going to say it's just Michelle. I get them. You get them. We all get them. And sometimes, and this is another song, and I don't know if this is on your list, so I apologize if I take this off of your list. But I always mention to Michelle, it's like, you need your I am Moana moment, you know, where you remember what you've been through, what you've done, go through. And sometimes you just need to take a pause and list. I've done this. I've done that. I've done this. I've done that. I am Moana, or I am Michelle. I am Tom. I am whatever. And remember that you have some significant value and you've done some impressive things in your life. And so every once in a while, I need to tell myself for that. And every once in a while, I'll remind Michelle that she needs to remember that as well.
You do. And it's always very helpful when you bring that up. So
very good. So yeah, Michelle's list, always the best list, especially when story time with Michelle is thrown into the equation as well.
All right, so we're now at your number four, baby.
My number four. Apparently, I was on a Sherman Brothers kick with this one, because my number four comes from a film that you may or may not know, and you may or may not know this song, but I think it's an impactful song just the same.
You're a castaway where no one hears you, on a barren isle in a lonely sea. Where did all the happy endings go? Where can all the good times be? You must face the age of not believing, doubting everything you ever knew, until at last you start believing there's something wonderful in you.
So if you don't know that song or that movie, that is called The Age of Not Believing, and it comes from the movie Bedknobs and Broomsticks. Obviously, you can tell by the voice, that's Angela Lansbury right there singing.
One of my favorite films.
Yeah. What I find I love about this song, the message within it. One, there's a little bit of the piece we were just talking about with Michelle. There's a little bit of that. You can face all this and you can fight through, you can get through it on the other side. But also more importantly, especially as a Disney adult, that I feel like many of us go through at times is like, we'll sometimes get ridiculed for still loving this Disney stuff and everything like that. And how that's for kids, right? And I feel like so many times you get to that spot in your life, and I think we go through it. A lot of us go through it where maybe Disney gets pushed to the side for a little bit because that was kid stuff. But then eventually you come back to it and realize, no, this is for, there should be a little bit of kid in all of us. And I think that's what that song says is like, look, yes, you have to be an adult at times. There are some things that are not fun that you're going to have to face. You cannot just be a child every moment of your life. But there are those wonderful moments when you can go and not be adulting, as they say, and embrace the child inside you, the believing in the magic that is out there. And Disney is such a great way to express that. And I think this song says exactly that in so many ways.
Absolutely. And I love that. And I love that choice. That's one of my favorite songs. But yeah, you're right. It's realizing that your inner joy, you know, can be tapped in on through Disney, whether you're talking films or going to the parks or just bounding or whatever. But yes, and I love that that exists in the world, that we have those elements that not only give us permission but encourage us to tap in, as you say, on our inner child.
Yes. So that's my number four. But again, let's get back to the real list. Michelle, what is your number three favorite Disney song with a message?
All right. Well, good news. My number three is just a three. and it is from one of my favorite animated worlds, and that is Phineas and Ferb, Us Against the Universe.
And even though we sometimes disagree, we're all together, we're a family. And friends are also family. We're not just talking.
All right. There's a lot of messages packed in that song there. That came from the film Us Against the Universe.
Candace Against the Universe.
Candace. Yes. Yeah, sorry. Candace Against the Universe. But I think also when I look at this song, first of all, I think it came out at a perfect time, right? The world was going through a pandemic together, you know, and that the message of we can succeed, if we do come together, and that, you know, like they said, if you try to do it on your own, you're going to take it on the chin. And that's something that we have, again, with the commonalities to help us get through struggles. And more recently now with two back-to-back hurricanes that came through in our country, this song can once again have that same type of message that is pertinent, that it, you know, and I feel it's so heartwarming when you see communities coming together, helping each other, and that you don't have to face things on your own.
Mm-hmm. And as the song says, it can be family, it can be found family,
right.
Essentially, because
exactly.
Friends are family as well. And it's so true, very true. And that song, well, that movie's so fun. But that song is a great song. It even thanks the animators, which they made the animation for the which cracks me up, which is so, it's so Phineas and Ferb. Yeah. But it's a great song. It's a great message. And it's, yeah, we can all stand together and we are stronger as a group than we are singularly, for right. sure.
And even if you're talking on a personal perspective, if you have certain goals, it's definitely easier to achieve them if you have other folks around you helping support that.
And part of me, by the way, just as a side note, completely different than what the message is here, I really wish this was a video episode because you should see Michelle lip syncing and dancing as these songs are going on. She's having so much fun. When it was taking it on the chin, when it mentions that, she almost like punched herself in the face. It was great. I wish you could see it. So good.
Oh, I don't know. I think people are lucky they didn't.
It was hilarious. I nearly fell out of my chair when you almost punched yourself in the face. So funny.
Okay, with that, I think we're up to your number three, sweetheart.
My number three. Tell, things are very goofy in here. And my number three happens to be a goofy song as well, but still has a pretty good message. If we listen to each other. So again, obviously, I know I'm from a Goofy movie. I probably didn't even need me to tell you that because it's one of the best songs in the Disney oeuvre
right.
of music. The message in it is very similar to what we've already discussed. Is like, look, if we were to take the time to listen to one another, maybe we would see more eye to eye, and that it could be more globally, as we've spoken about earlier, but it also could be very more intimate, as we're talking about, like with the Goofy movie between Max and Goofy, and the fact that they weren't talking with one another. And so they were struggling to get through this situation that they were in. Whereas if you just sit down and talk and listen to one another, then maybe you'll find out you're not that far apart, as they say. So that's kind of why I felt like the message in this movie is, one, is a great song. By the way, have you heard the pop punk version of this song? Because the new album with all the pop punk songs is one of my favorites off of the entire album. It's such a good version of that as well. But obviously this one's the classic and really good. But that's kind of the message I wanted to come across.
Yeah, no, great message. And you're right, if you are listening to each other, whether you come to an agreement together, at least you understand. You have an understanding. But yeah, you might even find you have common ground and not be that different.
Exactly.
So good one, babe.
Thanks. So that was my number three, but let's get back to the real list. Let's get to Michelle's number two favorite Disney song with a message.
Well, I guess I must have also been channeling the Sherman Brothers because my number two is one of theirs, one of the best classics that they wrote, and that is Feed the Birds from Mary Poppins.
Come feed the little birds, show them you care, and you'll be glad. Birds, that's what she cries.
have to admit this. I didn't really notice the message in this song.
Really?
When it first, you know, when I heard. I never really, you know, to me, it helped move the story along.
Well, we heard it on one of our hashtag Year of Lynn segments where it wasn't like it, like he disliked that song because right. he didn't understand it and it felt so sad.
Yes,
so
yes.
Maybe that's it. Maybe that's you right. and Lynn, you know,
I know.
Eye to eye, the talk genius, about eye to eye.
You know, genius minds, you know, have
right. our... Yes, 100%.
But it wasn't until we were on a Disney tour and heard the story, you know, first of all, of how Walt would routinely ask the Sherman brothers to come to his office and at the end of the week and play that on the piano in his office, and how he really got into that song. And actually a lot of times they said he would tear up, and because he saw the message that they had put into that song, and is that it doesn't take much to help each other. And, you know, it's not like you always have to do these great, enormous things to be effective. Sometimes just a little bit of, or just some empathy can go a long way in helping your fellow person, whether it be your family, friend, or stranger. And I think that's an important message to not lose sight of, that, you know, you don't have to really put yourself way out there to still be able to contribute to somebody else being able to get through something.
Yeah, agreed. As it says right in the lyrics, and I'm glad this is on your list because I had it as a B, and I'm like, okay, that's gonna be on her list, so I can not have to worry about that somewhere. Yeah. Because this is, talk about a song with a message. It's a huge message. And as a matter of fact, and one of the things that we've heard that Walt said when they would play these things on Friday nights, would afterwards he'd say, "Yep, boys, that's what it's all about." That song is what it's all about. Yeah, the tuppence is talking about such a minuscule amount. Tuppence is not a lot of money, you know? Right. So it's talking about that you don't need to make these grand gestures to help everything out. I mean, yes, grand gestures are nice. They're, you know, large amounts of donations, whatever it is, large amounts of help are great. It's the small things, though. More small things add up to larger things. And that's kind of where this tuppence was. Yeah. And such a really, really important message and a really, really great song.
Yeah, thank you, sweetie. All right, so then we're going to your number two, right?
My number two, and I think I'm doing this song just because, you know, I just love it when I get the chance to play this song, but there is a message behind it.
If I was in this game, rolling by the sand, taste the morning out there like ordinary men who freely walk about there just one day, and then I swear I'll be content with my share.
As you can see, I just play that because I just love that so much. Say what you want about The Hunchback of Notre Dame. The soundtrack for it is unbelievable. And Out There is one of the best songs, again, in the whole Disney oeuvre of music, in my opinion.
Right, right.
However, there's also a big message behind this song, and the fact that Quasimodo's there talking about that one chance to go out there and experience these things that many people just take for granted on a day-by-day basis, that, you know, and I've run into these situations too. I remember going back, we visited Boston several years ago, and you had a bunch of meetings to go to. It was like some sort of convention or some sort of meetings that you had to go to. And I just took the day to go walk the Freedom Trail while you were at these meetings. And you're walking along, and it's right in the middle of the city of Boston. And there's people going to and fro to work. And I'm amazed at all these historical sites you're going going through. And meanwhile, most of these people, they live it every day. And so you almost like, you just don't take note of it anymore because it's maybe it's your commute, it's your regular walk, whatever it is. You don't notice the finer things in life, the interesting things in life. And sometimes you just have to appreciate, take a break, take a step back and look at and appreciate some of these amazing things that are around you every day. And the fact that, you know, Quasimodo, like, I can't leave the bell tower. I don't get to experience all these, what seems maybe simple things that people experience on a day, every day in and day out basis. But if I could get out there, man, would that be great? And I think sometimes it's good for us to take a step back and think about things in that way as well.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a great message. And you're totally spot on that we get so wrapped up a lot of times that we don't even see and appreciate things that we have. And I think that's awesome one, babe. Good list.
Thanks. Not as good as your list.
I don't know.
Because as we're going to see, we're going to get back to the real list. Let's get back to Michelle's. Number one, the tip top favorite Disney song with a message.
Okay. Well, the funny thing is, I actually, when I was getting this ready, thought it was a Sherman Brothers song. But when I was looking at their book that I have, their autobiography, I saw in there that they didn't write this song. It's from the Jungle Book. It was a song that was already written when Walt assigned them to the project of Jungle Book, and it's the Bare Necessities.
And don't spend your time looking around for something you want that can't be found. When you find out you can live without it and go along not thinking about it, I'll tell you something true. The bare necessities of life will come to you. Look for the bare necessities, the simple bare necessities. Forget about your worries and your strife. I mean a bare necessities. That's why a bear can rest at ease with just the bare necessities of life. Yeah, with just the bare necessities of life.
All right, so I will go into the message and why I chose this one. But one thing I want to share with you all is, and I got to record it someday, make a video of it. When Scott sings this song, it is the cutest thing because you can tell in his face that he's proud he can say the word necessities. It's not 100%.
I can't perfect. Say that word.
I know, but it is just so cute, you know, that you could just see every time he says the word, he's like, oh, wow, I just said that. But anyways, that song was not written by the Sherman Brothers. It was by Terry Gilkison. And he wrote a few other songs for Disney films. But anyways, the song's message is probably pretty obvious to people. What's important are the real necessities of life. And that, you know, again, sharing some personal feelings, a green-eyed monster can become overwhelming for me sometimes. And I think of Inside Out, too, in the console. Envy sometimes really takes control over that console a little bit more than I'd like it to, or her to. But anyways, I know it's silly to look at what others have and think, oh, I wish I had that. But that's just taking my attention away from what I do have, which is really great, you know, and kind of like with the Quasimodo song, stopping and reflecting and appreciating what I do have, because it's all really great. And I think it's an important message to be able to tap into your joy. And the other aspect of this song that I thought of is sometimes when you mess up, you know, you dwell on it, right? And you're like, oh God, if I could only have a do-over or whatever. But the reality is, if it's not really important, if you didn't really harm somebody for the long haul, let it go. Which I'm surprised we haven't heard that song yet. Yeah. But anyways, it's the bare necessities that are really important in life. And sometimes you really need to reflect on that too.
I agree. It's a fun little song, but there is some really, there's a nice little message in there about, Yeah, you know, sometimes if you don't need it, you know, don't fret on it. You can go on living without it. You don't necessarily need to stress on this thing that maybe you can't get. You will get through just fine. Now, you can't have everything, and no one wants everything. You know, I mean, you may think you want everything, but when it's all said and done, that's, everything is too much.
Right. Then you wouldn't appreciate it because right. it's all easy and all there.
Exactly.
That's nothing special about it.
Very good. Michelle's choice. Michelle's list. Always the best list. 100%.
You've had a pretty impressive list yourself, baby.
I don't know.
And now we're at your number one here.
I don't know. Well, I do have a number one. And it does. I actually have, in true Hyperion Adventures podcast fashion, I have a 1A and a 1B because, hey, you know. That's what we do here on this show. But I do feel that they have kind of a similar message and they talk about it and move things along and they extrapolate it as you go along. And so I think that they play together very well. Oh, and also, as we all know... So that is the first part of this message.
As I was for being funny when I said that.
As for 1B, well, as we all know,
show yourself.
So obviously, Let It Go from Frozen and Show Yourself from Frozen 2, as we all know, hashtag real men love Frozen. So of course, they're going to be somewhere on my list. I'm surprised it lasted that long, right?
Oh, no. I actually kind of thought, oh, okay, so he's not going to do a Frozen
song. Yeah, well, so the reason why, the message behind these two songs, and they do kind of tie into Elsa's journey, obviously, but they are important things for... I feel everybody to go through, and it is kind of that journey that you go through of self-discovery, of self-acceptance, and it goes and it moves on throughout both these films. Obviously, the first part, Let It Go, you know, cutting those ties that bind, set by the true villain of that film, which I won't get into here, but at some point I'd be happy to get into the true villain of Frozen. Those ties that bind you, that, you know, it's time to break free and discover, look, I'm good with this. The cold never bothered me anyway. I'm fine with who I am, with that I have this power, that I'm strong. Maybe I need to step away from everybody for a bit. You know, there's an issue there, and that may be tied into that villain as well. But she is willing to accept that. Then with Show Yourself in Frozen 2, it's being comfortable in your own skin and knowing that maybe... there are times when I need to adapt and grow and change a little bit and accept what is to evolve, to step into your power and move into that new space. It's all part of growth throughout your life. Elsa's growth, our growth. We all go through this in some way, shape, or form throughout our lives, whether it be to become a better version of the person we are, whether it to be changing careers, changing, making big life steps, whatever. All these things play into that. They are just something that kind of happened within this film that were expressed by these two songs.
Right. Yeah, I totally agree. I love that you included both of those songs. Yeah, when you talk about the Let It Go, you know, it's the kind of similar to what we were saying before, the things that are self-limiting, right? Something that you might feel is detrimental to what you really want to do is actually a strength. And I think it's great to include that in the message that you brought along. I love it.
Thank you. Thank you. So, yeah, that's my list. Yeah, of course, I was going to hashtag Real Men Love Frozen. I was going to get Frozen in there somewhere. You had to know. You had to know. Anyway, we'd love to hear your list. Please let us know what your list would be. What would be on your five favorite Disney songs with a message? Also, did you have any honorable mentions, Michelle, that we didn't hit that you can think of right off the bat?
Well, you know what? Believe it or not, the Let It Go was an honorable mention for me. I had that. You know what? I thought I had them on my list here, but I don't see them. So.
Okay, I'll go through a few that I have here. From Princess and the Frog, Dig a Little Deeper, I think is it a great one to kind of, hey, you got to work a little harder. You got to know yourself and also dig through things and work a little harder if you want to get to your goals a little bit. I think that's obviously Go the Distance from Hercules is a great one. I'm really surprised that wasn't on Michelle's list. I thought sure that was going to be one, that is important for everybody is inspire, make your way through it. You can do this. You can go the distance.
Yeah. I mean, actually I wanted that one to be on my list, but I realized, one of the last times we did a Disney songs list that I had used that multiple times. And I thought, all right, I got to expand my list to not always have the same songs.
There you go. Not me. Apparently not me. I don't need to do that. From speaking of a song that obviously didn't make my list because I like to go to my favorites. But this is a great song that I love very much. I'm from Brother Bear, On My Way. Can tell everybody I'm on my way. Like I'm going to make this journey. I'm going to go through this. And I just tell everybody, hey, I'm going to make it through. I'm going to make it through that. I think that's a good one as well. And this is the only one I'm going to play out of my honorable mentions that really is surprising it wasn't on either of our lists. But this is a great one, too.
Like a moon out of the blue, fate steps in and sees you through one blush. Your dreams come.
So obviously when you wish upon a star.
Right. It was actually on my list.
Yeah, it was
high
on mine
on my
too.
List too. I don't know. I think I must have deleted the end of my files here. my honorable mentions, but yes, that one was definitely.
Yeah, it's important. It's important to have wishes, to have dreams. It's like it goes back to the one little spark, the journey into imagination. Right. It's important to have those, that imagination, that spark, that dream, wishing on stars, whatever it is, it takes you, kind of leads you to where you want to get to. And yes, just by wishing doesn't make it happen. You got to dig a little deeper and make these things happen. But those wishes do start moving things in the right direction.
Yeah, you have to have that dream, the desire for something in order for it to get moving. So definitely great.
Very good. Great list, Michelle.
Oh, honey, great, yours is really
great segment as always. And that is our five favorite Disney songs with a message. So many great songs with messages from Disney. We didn't even scratch the surface, I have a feeling. There are a ton of other ones that didn't even make the honorable mentions that probably should have, right, Michelle?
Oh, yeah. It was actually kind of tough to, well, obviously, since we had A's and B's for both of us, to keep the list to a manageable amount. But yeah, there are so many.
So many. Like I said, I was surprised. I thought, oh, this is going to be a little bit of a struggle. And then I was going through, I'm like, oh, this is going to be a struggle to actually limit the list.
Right.
I'm sure there's some that we missed out there. We'd love to know yours. Please send them to us. Now, before we get to the Disney stories of the week, we're doing this thing where we are trying to bring one Lin-Manuel Miranda onto the show, at least to acknowledge the show, whether it be on social media, a message, preferably an interview, as we head towards 2025, and that is the 10-year anniversary of Hamilton on Broadway and the 5-year anniversary of Hamilton on Disney Plus. So we're doing this thing where we're kind of bringing out some fun facts, some interesting tidbits about Lin or some of the stuff that he's doing. We call it the hashtag Year of Lin. So I thought for this week, maybe this would be an appropriate thing for this week, since our theme is kind of songs with a message. And I was going to look back at Hamilton a little bit. And there are so many actual songs within Hamilton that have a message. But I also thought that this was appropriate for this week to talk about the song Hurricane, of all things. Because I think that this is a very pivotal song in many ways in the musical Hamilton. I that's probably not a stretch for me to say. And you know that if you know the Hamilton soundtrack, if you know the show, you know how pivotal this song is. But that's because, and one of the things about this is this song also has deeper meanings when it, obviously for the character of Alexander Hamilton, but also there's some interesting meaning in it musically. Let's hear a little bit of this song.
In the eye of a hurricane, there is quiet for just a moment. A yellow sky. When I was 17, a hurricane destroyed my town. I didn't drown, I couldn't seem to die. I wrote my way out, wrote everything down far as I could see. I wrote my way out. I looked up and the town had its eyes on me. They passed a plate around. Total strangers moved to kindness by my story. Raised enough for me to book passage on a ship that was New York bound. My way out of hell. I wrote my way to revolution. I was louder than the crack in the bell. I wrote Eliza love letters until she fell. I wrote about the Constitution and defended it well. And in the face of ignorance and resistance, I wrote financial systems into existence. And when my prayers to God were met with indifference, I picked up a pen. I wrote my own deliverance. In the eye of a hurricane, there is quiet for just a moment.
Okay, so there's a lot just in that segment there that happened within that song that ties in with everything that's going on in the story, but also with a hurricane itself, right. Okay? So, obviously, this is all dealing with Hamilton's inner struggle of what do I do, what do I deal with, and the tumultuous point in his life when he makes known his transgressions, some of the things that he's done that are not great. So, but what I find interesting is, one, the tie-in to the hurricane, and I think we see that around here after every storm, but especially after this storm of, you know, people passing a plate around, inspired by stories. We see the charity. We've discussed it already earlier in the show, the charity that comes out with this. I find it fascinating that that kind of comes out in this. The softer sounds of the music when we're talking about the eye of the hurricane, you know, that peaceful, calm period. And you can kind of hear Lin as Alexander Hamilton kind of in okay with himself at that moment. And then you get to the outer edge of the eye and the music ramps up and you can feel that's where it's super tumultuous and everything is being stirred up and everything is going. You can hear him getting stirred up over there. And then he's back in the eye again. It is very fascinating the way that song is giving the message of what's going on and what goes on in our own lives and how we deal with it, and also what goes on in a hurricane and musically, lyrically, it's just it's so fascinating to listen to.
Oh, definitely. I mean, like you said, it's the words, it's the tones, it's the pace of the music that all ties in together so beautifully and tells that story. And yes, I think the imagery of hurricane can be utilized, and it is, he utilizes it in this story so magnificently. It does have a lot of meaning to it of, you know, because people can understand what is a hurricane. They can understand that the eye part of the hurricane is when the winds are dead and it's quiet and it's, eerie, actually. And I think that is such a true imagery usage that he has.
Yeah, it's very much symbolism to what we all go through many times during our lives, where we kind of have that storm brewing around us with things that are, it could be, you know, something happening at work, it could be something happening at home. There's that calm period, those periods where everything seems stirred up and crazy. And using the analogy of tying in a hurricane to it is fascinating, especially considering Hamilton's life of going through that hurricane situation. And there's so many, this musical, so many of these interesting little things. There's a part, I didn't want to play the whole song, obviously. I played a large portion of it, where we start bringing in Wait For It from, of course, Aaron Burr. And, you know, when, you know, there's that time when, you know, maybe Hamilton should have been more like Burr, and those times when Burr should have been more like Hamilton, and they play out throughout the musical. It's brilliant. It's so good. But I just wanted to bring up that part because I think it tied in with what happened this week and with our episode a little bit as well.
Yeah. And interestingly, not Hamilton, Lin-Manuel used Hurricane in Encanto, in one of the songs in Encanto, that he tied that in as well. You know, it's, like I said, it's powerful imagery.
For sure, for sure. So that is this week's episode, or portion of this episode, of our hashtag Year of Lin. Yes. Now, before we get to the Disney stories of the week, you know, we need to talk about our great friend Nate with Main Street and More Travel, because let's face it, we all have trips we're thinking about taking in the very near future. Well, if you do, whether it be to Walt Disney World, Disneyland, Disney Cruise, or anywhere in the world beyond, let me tell you, Nate is the certified Disney vacation planner that you are going to want to get in contact with.
Oh my gosh, for sure. You know, as we, you know, mention all the time, he really has firsthand knowledge of things, so he can really help you plan, customize a trip that is going to be the best for you, answer your questions. It's really concierge level planning that doesn't cost you anything.
High end. It is high end stuff that he will help you out with, answer all your questions. He is there for you to make sure your trip, wherever it may be the best it possibly can be. And as Michelle mentioned, no extra cost to you. That's because either Disney or whatever other travel branch that he works through pays him for you. What you end up paying is exactly what you pay. If you did all that work yourself, only you can save that time and just relax and enjoy and let him set it all up for you.
Right. And you know what? He may even be able to save you some money from you doing it alone, because he is on top of all the deals and steals that are out there.
Yeah. And there's never a guarantee, but let me tell you, if there's a discount out there, Nate will find it for you. So what you got to do is go to DizTripsAndMore.com, fill out the form there, and just contact him. Talk to him. Tell him what you want to do and let him get to work for you.
Right. So as Tom mentioned, once you fill out that form, Nate will be back in touch with you to start that planning. But be sure to tell him that Tom and Michelle sent you.
Yeah. Again, that's Nate with Main Street and More Travel. So Nate just got back from a Disney cruise, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, I think it was kind of going around where everything was happening in the Gulf. I haven't talked with him yet. I can't wait to hear his stories about what they were dealing with on that Disney cruise, because look, the Disney Wish there had a sailing completely canceled because of the, you know, what was happening.
Right. And the one that was already in place.
Right.
Got extended because of that. So they actually got to go to Castaway Key.
Wow.
I think it was yesterday, because they're coming back today.
Oh, interesting. I didn't know that. I thought they were coming back on Friday, but they didn't come back on Friday.
No,
huh?
Oh, no, they extended their day. Because they weren't sure if the port was going to allow them in.
Gotcha. Be interesting. Operational. Interesting. Yeah. So I can't wait to talk to Nate about that for sure. And we have some other travel things to talk to him about, because Nate is so great at dealing with travel stuff. All right, let's go ahead and get to the Disney stories of the week. Just a couple for you this week. I'm trying to pare down these Disney stories. If you want to hear more Disney stories, check into our Hyperion Morning show. I talk about Disney stories along with a lot of other fun stuff there, but I'm trying to kind of streamline this show a little bit. And when there's not a lot of great stories, I'm not going to throw in stories just to throw in stories, but I do have some interesting ones this week. And I'm going to start with, when can we do this again?
Yeah, it's been fun, but no one got to go. Life is way too short to take it slow. Before I go and hit the road.
it's pretty soon. And you may wonder why I'm playing that song. If you've never seen the Paint the Night Parade, that is the basic soundtrack of the Paint the Night Parade. There is some other stuff around it as well, but that is the main portion of the Paint the Night Parade, of course, from Owl City, from Ralph Breaks the Internet. You may know it. But yes, from a Disney Parks social media post, they hinted that the Paint the Night Parade is coming back to the Disneyland Resort sometime in the somewhat near future.
I know. And when you told me this week, I thought, oh, talk about green-eyed monster. I think one of the most exciting, fun, joyous times I ever had at Disneyland Resort was when we got to experience the Paint the Night Parade through a dessert package. And I don't think that could even be recreated. It was so special.
Yeah. I mean, if you want to go back again, going back to episodes, I think it may have been our second or third episode we've ever done. I mean, please bear with us, from what we were at that point. But I think we discussed that going to that, that dessert. It was kind of a savory one, wasn't it? Well, it was a dining package where we got to go and have some snacks and some drinks.
Yeah, it wasn't a meal.
It was like some charcuterie or something along those lines, and some other things, and some desserts I think were included in it. But and get these wonderful seats to watch the Paint the Night Parade, which I don't know about you, but it may be, obviously for nostalgia purposes, the Main Street Electrical Parade is great. I think I like the Paint the Night Parade even more. It's like it's the Main Street Electrical Parade. I hate to say on steroids because it's so cliche, but that is kind of what it is.
Yeah, it's obviously more updated, both technology and music wise and stuff. But yeah, it's because I think it has a bouncier beat to the song and everything. It is somewhat better than the first one. I don't know if I could say that. But
they're both great. Different. We love them both. But if I could only go to one, I think I'd go to the Paint the Night Parade, but maybe that's just because I've seen the Main Street Electrical Parade more recently. I don't know. Paint the Night, pretty darn good.
Yeah.
Pretty darn good. Happy it's coming back. No official word on dates set yet. There is some speculation out there that it may be summer of 2025 because that is when the Disneyland Resort is turning 70. So sometime around that time, if that's the case, hopefully it runs long enough. We're thinking we're going to have a Disneyland trip coming somewhere in early 2026. And hopefully that they will keep it running for the entire year. That'd be really nice if they would do that for us, because we would really love to see this. We'd love to see it again.
Yes.
keeping our fingers crossed that that's the case. But no matter what, happy for everybody who is going to get to experience it, whether it be the first time, whether it be for the 80th time. I'm very, very happy for you.
Right. Yeah. It's wonderful.
Yeah, it is. It really is wonderful. And if you get a chance to go see it, do it. Do it. It's amazing. It is a great nighttime parade for sure. Also, talking about the happiest place on earth, we do know this date of when the Magic Key holders will have their chance to preview Tiana's Bayou Adventure at Disneyland. That's coming up. So this came, we will check this out on the Disneyland website. It will be happening on select dates from October 21st through November 12th. Now, it's not every day, so you'll want to check the schedule there and find out what dates that is available if you're a Magic Key holder. Again, you will need to be a Magic Key holder to take part in this, and you will have to have a park reservation for that day. And they'll be doing it very similarly to what they did here in Walt Disney World at Magic Kingdom when they opened it up. You won't have to book this thing in advance. You'll just need to have that park reservation, but you will need to join a virtual queue 7 a.m. on that day that it's happening. Will be your first chance to do it. And then if you are in the parks at the time, you will have a second chance at noon to get, especially if they have the later times. So you'll have a couple opportunities to kind of book this. I know that we were concerned when they were doing it here that we would, get the park reservation, make plans, take days off, whatever it might be, and then not land a virtual queue. But from whatever we heard, that it didn't seem that difficult, that most people, I didn't hear anybody really saying, I've tried numerous times and I've not been able to land the virtual queue. So still do your best effort to get it, and don't, you know, make sure you don't base your day around it. But it could be a possibility. It looks like it's a very good possibility that you will land one of these virtual queues. And also, by the way, this also, I know when Walt Disney World's first opened up, there were some glitches sometimes, and sometimes it was delayed on getting those boarding groups started for it. Don't know if that will be the case at Disneyland, if they've ironed out some of those bugs. It seems like Tiana's Bayou Adventure is running more smoothly now than it used to be at Walt Disney World. Hopefully that'll be the case when it starts at Disneyland as well.
Yeah, so happy that they've got that information out for folks. So
yeah, so definitely go to either the Disneyland app or the Disneyland website and go look at those dates so you can plan ahead and know when you'll have your chance again if you're a Magic Key holder. Also, there are some discounts coming for Magic Key holders for Lightning Lane, Lightning Lane Multipass coming up on certain days. You'll want to check into the calendar on that, possibly up to 50% off of Lightning Lane Multipass coming up. They did also announce that the prices are going up for Magic Key. So, but prices go up for everything. They're not going on sale yet again. They're not. There's a pause on sales of Magic Keys right now, but probably will open those up again eventually here. Don't know if it'll be after Tiana's Bayou Adventure previews are done. I'm guessing probably so, since they haven't announced dates yet, but keep your eyes open. You never know. As far as non-preview days, the attraction officially opens on November 15th. So even if you don't have, you're not a Magic Key holder, or you just don't have the chance to get out there or whatever, your chance is coming up very, very soon.
Yeah. Now, if you are a Magic Key holder, you can renew your,
right,
your passes.
But if you need to,
yeah,
yes.
The pause is for new sales.
Right. And you may, if you're on the border, because the price is going to be going up here very soon, you may want to just go ahead and renew it at the lesser price while you can right now, because the price is going to be going up here. So just know that going in. But I hope you get to experience Tiana's Bayou Adventure for everybody on the West Coast soon, because it is such a joyous, wonderful, fun attraction, and we really love it.
Yeah, yeah. You'll really love the story, the audio animatronics, and the experience.
Yes, for sure. So that's it for the Disney stories of the week. However, we never leave you without giving you some sort of tip that might help you on your next vacation. And when we do this, we always start with Michelle, because she's wonderful. She's amazing. She's all things great in the world, and she has apparently the best stories. She also has the best list. You just heard that. You know she does the best research, but one thing is for certain, she always has the best tips. So let's get to it. Here's Michelle's tip of the week.
All right. Before my tip, though, I'm holding this in. I just, you know, talk about green-eyed monster or envy really getting involved. If you're lucky enough to be going to the New York Comic Con the end of the week, you'll have an opportunity, as they say on the show, getting the band together for Phineas and Ferb. Mm-hmm. They're going to be giving a sneak preview of the first episode that's going to be coming on that new series that's returning. Mm-hmm. And I was surprised to read that they were saying it's the first time in 10 years the group came together for a panel, for a con panel. And then I realized I was at that one 10 years ago. But not that I, you know, that's another story. I didn't go for that because at the time I wasn't synced into that series.
Yeah, if you'd only known.
If I had only known.
You probably would have been a puddle, as everybody, from what I understand, since you went to that panel. I was not at Comic-Con for that panel, but you said that everybody, because it was the final season at that point, what we thought of was the final season of Phineas and Ferb, and everybody was in tears.
Yeah, it was great.
So you would have been too.
Yes, for sure. But anyways, I digress. All right, tip of the week. If you're thinking about traveling over to Disneyland Paris, and we've talked about how there are certain perks that you get from staying at a Disney hotel. Well, the one that I thought was amazing with the Disneyland Paris hotel is that once you've confirmed, booked your reservation for the stay at the hotel, you can begin your dining reservations for like the table service as soon as you have that booking confirmation. So all the other guests have to wait to make that reservation 2 months in advance. So that can be a real significant perk to have that ability to do that. And I'm not saying paid in full. You can have your deposit on there. And the other nice thing that Disneyland Paris allows is for you to do installation payments for their packages.
Wow. Very good. Yeah. We nearly were going to Disneyland Paris next year, and then we kind of pivoted from that and are putting that off for at least a year or two. But we do have plans to get back there because we love Disneyland Paris. So it's good. Yeah, you have different ways to handle it for sure.
Yeah. But take advantage of that extra booking option that you have.
100%. Very good. Michelle's tip. Always the best tip. My tip this week. Well, apparently this is the episode where we're talking about hurricanes, but something I want to mention to you is the fact that, you know where a great place is to ride out a hurricane? It's the Walt Disney World Resort because they do a fantastic job. I say this mostly because it can be scary thinking about that you're planning these vacations and you may be booking it during hurricane season. Maybe that's the only time it's available for you. And it's like, okay, well, what happens if one of these big storms comes through? And I'm going to tell you right now, and it was proven again this week that one of the best places you could possibly ride out one of these storms is the Walt Disney World Resort. These buildings are meant to weather literally these storms. And they have a great power system there. They have generators to back it up. The power, they're on their own grid. Almost all their power lines are underground, so you don't have to worry about them snapping or anything like that happening. We've heard many reports. Our great friend, Tony the Disney Dad, we checked in with him to ask him because he's had to go through storms there before and to ask him because we were considering it at one point this week, having Michelle and Scott go out there and ride the storm out there. We ended up pivoting from that, but we did consider it. What was his experience? He would say it was great. You know, there was a point where they kind of lock you down in the building, but the power always stayed on. There was never this issue. The cast members there take care of you really well. They do things to kind of help the kids be entertained when you can't get into the parks. And they really do things really well to make sure, one, you're safe, but two, that you're also still entertained. So obviously you don't want that to happen during your vacation, but if it does, you know, you're safe and even the kids are going to be okay when you're at the Walt Disney World Resort.
Yeah. And the cast members really do an amazing job. First and foremost, safety is the key that they're looking for. But as you said, they're also really in tune to the fact that they need to provide some distraction, some fun, while people are there.
Yeah. Within a safe concept. That's the main thing. And yeah, of course, Disney does get damaged. There is damage. There was some damage from what I understand to some of the roofs at the Poly, and that does happen. But all in all, they make it through these storms pretty darn well. And that's a credit to their construction, and it's a credit to the people there that take care of it. And I want to reach out and say thank you to all the cast members that stuck around and volunteered and were there helping people throughout the situation. And then they continue on, whether it was pre-storm or whether now it's post-storm with the cleanup out there. Thank you for all you do on a daily basis, but also especially even when things are more difficult, for stepping in and doing so much to help everybody out there enjoy their time and make sure, again, that everybody is safe.
Right. Yeah. Good one, honey.
Thanks, sweetheart. So that's it for this week's show. Next week, well, if you've ever considered joining the Disney Vacation Club, our next episode may be one that you don't want to miss. We hope all our episodes are ones you don't want to miss, but this one specifically, because we'll be discussing everything we know about DVC and try and help you, give you some information to help you decide if it might be right for you. Right, Michelle?
Yeah, especially, you know, like if it might be something that you had never thought about that you decide, hey, maybe this is right for me. But it may be for somebody who's on the fence, give you enough information to say yay or nay.
Yeah. I mean, and it's one thing, like, it was right for us. It's not right for everybody. And I'm sure we'll express that next week. It may not be right for you, but it's good to have the information. And I think one thing is we will always say is that we wish we bought in earlier. Since it is right for us, we wish we had bought in earlier, but we didn't have all the information. So we're going to try and share some of that information with you so you can at least have a base to go into and then decide if you want to meet with somebody to even show interest even more than that.
Yeah. And we'll be honest with you. We're not, because again, we do recognize it isn't for everyone.
It's so definitely
we're not, you know, there's no benefit for us whether somebody joins or not. So we're not part of the team that tries to sell anything. We just want to share our experiences and our knowledge that, we had wished we had had before we did make our
maybe decision. I can even convince Michelle to do another one of her wonderful PowerPoint presentations. Ooh. To go along with that. She loves to do PowerPoint presentations.
So maybe
maybe no guarantees, but maybe it'll be a video episode next week as well.
Right.
We'll see. Anyway, that's next week. As for today's show, we appreciate that you join us today. In the future, you can find us most everywhere you get podcasts. However, the very best place to find us is on our own website, HyperionAdventuresPodcast.com. Also, we are on social media. We're on Twitter at Hyperion Podcast, Facebook, Instagram, and Threads at Hyperion Adventures Podcast. If you are on Facebook, come on over and join us for some good, positive Disney energy fun on our Hyperion Adventures Facebook group. Also, we are on YouTube, and please subscribe to us on YouTube because we're doing a lot more there, including a show almost every single morning on YouTube. If you want to find us there, we're at Hyperion Adventures Podcast. And if you ever want to contact us for any reason, please hit us up at our Gmail account, HyperionAdventuresPodcast@gmail.com.
And we really appreciate if you tell some friends about this podcast.
Yep, great way to get the word out. Just tell a friend. Tell a friend, and we can have more in our Hyperion Adventurer community. And that's what we really want to do here. And thank you for listening to another episode of the Hyperion Adventures podcast. We look forward to sharing some time with you again next week. Until that time, I'm Tom.
I'm Michelle.
And we hope that you have a magical week.
Bye.